deals with honesty. The type of honesty that we should have with our Lord Jesus Christ. The honesty that's becoming of his character, his reverence, his love, his affection for one and all. So let's take a moment for a small prayer here. Father in heaven, we thank you, Father. Again, we come to you this wonderful day, your day of rest and worship. We ask that your presence be with us, that the Holy Spirit guide us in your word, in your instructions, and in your principles that you have given us to live by. For they represent your character. And we ask all of this, Father, in your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Let us turn to chapter 7, Honesty with God. Let's read the memory text. But that on the good ground are they which in honest and good heart, having heard the word, keep it and bring forth fruit with patience. Luke 8:15. In order for the branch, this is the relationship of believers to Christ, and in order for the branch to produce more fruit, it must abide, which means to dwell, to stay, to settle in, to seek deeper. The way to abide in Christ is to obey. The believer who lovingly obeys the word of God produces much fruit. Apart from Christ, a believer cannot accomplish anything of pertinent spiritual value. We were not born with an inclination to be honest, and that's a fact. It is a learned moral virtue and is at the core of a steward's moral character. All that man receives of God's bounty still belongs to God. Whatever God has bestowed in the value and beautiful things of earth is placed in his hands. A man to test and test them to sound the depths of their love for him and their appreciation of his favors. Whether it be treasures of wealth or of intellect, they are to be laid a willing offering at the feet of Jesus, the giver, saying meanwhile, like David, all things come from thee, and of thine own have we given thee. Our hearts are naturally sinful in the service of Christ, and we need to be guarded constantly, grounded constantly, or we shall fail to endeavor. When we practice honesty, good things come from it. Honesty is a valued personality trait, especially under difficult situations when the temptation might easily be towards dishonesty. I think we all can relate to this, and I'm sure we all can relate to this. We need to draw near to God, for God rewards not only those who seek Him, but those who do not work, who do good works in the Holy Spirit's power. Those who realize their dependence upon God will feel that they must be honest with their fellow men. And above all, we must be honest with God, from whom all the blessings of life. But before I continue, let us define honesty. What is honesty? What is honesty? Anybody?
It's truth.
What does it mean to be honest with God?
To do it correctly. Mm-hmm.
Being honest with God,
you said?
Well, you're not playing games with God. You're being straightforward.
Absolutely. I mean, there's many things that we could say honesty. Because if we don't have honesty, who are we dependent on? Honesty as a character quality is a sign of the Spirit's work in a person's soul. Yes, brother.
I think about your question. Honesty. A human being cannot be honest if they don't know God's truth.
Absolutely.
So there's an honesty according to God. There's an honesty according to the world.
Absolutely.
Because you're referring to motives too, right?
It's all intertwined.
Right, it is.
It's all intertwined.
Right, it is.
But knowing truth, as God has described
it,
and the scripture says, I am truth.
Right, that is, yes.
So that's the only truth that saves.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
The truth of the world destroys.
So how do we become the honest person towards God?
Huh?
How do we become the honest person towards God?
Study. Commit.
Yeah. I don't think you can have it without the Holy Spirit.
Well, absolutely.
I think you have to ask
absolutely.
The Holy Spirit to come in you.
See, we need to develop the character of God, of Christ. Those are principles that we need to be living by.
And as Teresa just said, and it's all intertwined, the Holy Spirit
absolutely. Absolutely.
Is the only one that can lead us to truth.
Father, Son, and Holy
right.
Spirit.
Right.
Well, and also, part of that is living up to the light that you have while you are learning.
Yes.
Because you don't just come in and know everything.
No. Right.
To any church,
yes.
If you walk in any church's doors, our truth comes from the scripture. But if you've never read the scripture and you have no idea kind of what it says, you just know there's a God named Jesus.
Absolutely.
And then you learn that He died for you, lived a sinless life, died for you, and risen again so that you might inherit with Him. Then you begin living, and hopefully up to the truth that you have. If you're not, you're still lying to yourself and to Him.
Well, we ought to be partaking.
But the thing is, we can't lie to God.
Absolutely.
In our minds or in our actions. Because He knows us better than we know ourselves.
Absolutely. So
but He also knows
yeah.
when we're sincerely trying and haven't gotten it yet, too.
Actually, I think we can lie to God. He knows you're lying, but I think we
but
can.
Oh, yeah,
you
absolutely.
Can try
yeah.
and lie to Him.
Yeah,
you really
right.
are not lying
yeah.
to Him because He knows it's
right.
We're
we
all in the same
ourselves.
Page.
Yeah.
We're all in the
that's
same
where
page.
Where the play in the games comes in.
So we need to be adhering to the attributes of the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Listening.
All of the combined, Father, Son, and
yes,
Holy
all
Spirit.
Under one.
Yes. The evasion of the positive commands of God concerning tithes and offerings is registered in the book of heaven as robbery towards God.
Mm-hmm.
And you can find more on that if you look in Councils on Stewardship, page 77, chapter 29. It is time to embrace the larger biblical view of stewardship, which goes beyond church budgets or building projects. Though important, it connects everything we do with what God is doing in the world. We need to be faithful stewards of all God has given us within the opportunities presented through His providence to glorify Him, serve the common good, and further His kingdom. Before we go any further, I would like to probably give us a little bit of a foundation or go back to the fundamentals of stewardship so that it needs to be brought over and over because it's something that we probably know of or some of us don't even want to know of, but it needs to be brought up constantly.
Amen.
Before continuing, let us refresh the stewardship with God. What is man as a steward?
What is what?
What is man as a steward?
As a
steward. What is man as a steward?
Are we not to reflect God and His character? Go to the book of Genesis 1, verse 26. And before that, let me read something. A steward is a person who is manager of another's goods. With such responsibility, there always comes a day of reckoning. Sooner or later, the time arrives when the steward will be called upon to render personal account. Genesis 1:26. Over what was man dominion after the creation of all things? What did God put man to care about?
The animals, the world.
And the earth.
The Father said, Genesis 1:26, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowls of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon earth. Genesis 1:26. This establishes, it is an establishing. At the beginning, we're talking about Genesis. The establishing, the foundation of stewardship. What was man given, though? We just read that. Did the world belong to man? Did the world belong to man? God says in Psalms 24:1, God said, the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the world. The world and they that dwell therein.
Psalms
24:1. The Lord entrusted the management of things on the earth to man. And that's what we just read. And the Lord took, and the Lord God took man, the man, and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. Genesis 2:15. Let's turn to Psalms 1:15-16. The heavens, even the heavens are the Lord's, but the earth has He given to the children of men. Genesis 1:28.
16.
Yeah, Psalm 115, 16. And I'm going to be reading Genesis 1:28. And God blessed them. And God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowls of the air, over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. The fundamental principle of biblical stewardship is that God owns everything. We are simply managers, administrators, acting on his behalf. Unfaithful on the part of man was sin. Unfaithfulness on the part of man was sin. However, God promised to redeem fallen man, and that's Genesis 3:15. God pronounced judgment on the evil and predicted the coming of one to deliver man from sin. What does God require of us as stewards today? Our question should be, what shall I render unto the Lord for all his benefits towards me? And that is found in Psalms 116, verse 12. Let us continue to Sunday's lesson. A matter of simple honesty. One thing I think most of us have in common is that we do not like dishonesty. Am I right?
Amen.
I'm sure that most of us have seen this dishonesty manifested in others. So it would be prudent that when faced with this type of occurrences, that we take the initiative to correct the issue at hand, right there and then on the spot. Because if we don't, what good is it? We're being dishonest to ourselves and to whoever.
Yeah, with Forrest about a week ago.
Yes.
I was thinking, is it mom's tuition? I'm going to check the mileage on his truck. So I went out there and I checked the mileage. Next day I came home from work and I looked at the mileage and it hadn't changed. And he said, oh, I got home from work early. I said, oh, really? Mm-hmm. I said, you know what? I said, you didn't go to work. Oh, yes, I did. I said, no, you didn't, because I checked the mileage. And he was just like dumbstruck. And then his excuse, well, I just didn't want to hurt you, was his reason for being dishonest, you know. And the twisted reasoning.
Absolutely. So that is a person in desperation.
That's what I said. Think of it logically. You don't think we're going to find out the truth. It's better to be.
And it was worse.
That
is the selfish attitude that affects way too many people. So we need to correct that. Especially we that are in the Word. We're more responsible than the person that doesn't know anything.
That's very, very true.
Absolutely. And good thing you did. You came about it the right way. Because you approach that individual and you make the corrections that needed to be made.
Yeah, well, I made him think about it. I said, you're hurting the people that you work for. You're treating them bad. You're lying.
Well, you did the right thing.
All around, it was.
Yeah. The hard part is that when we ourselves are faced with this dilemma, we tend to rationalize our action by justification. We tend to downplay their significance. We fool ourselves, but we can never fool God. We think we're getting away with it. No, we're not. No, we're not. Mm-hmm. When this happens, we become detached from Christ and only deceive ourselves, which is even worse. I mean, you know truth from wrong. How will you justify yourself when the time comes? It is the little things of life that develop the spirit and determine the character. It is only by acting in accordance with the principles of God's word in small matters of life that we place ourselves on the right side. Our character will be estimated according to our works. God knows easily we can be dishonest when it comes to things we possess, especially in many occasions. We need to come to terms and recognize our obligation to God. The Lord sought to teach Israel that in everything he must be first. Everything that we possess is his. We are but stewards of his goods. Turn to Proverbs 14, verses 16 to 19. Proverbs 14, 16 to 19. Let me know when you're there. Okay. I'll go ahead.
14, 16 to 19.
Now proceed with it. A wise man feareth and departeth from evil. But the fool rageth and is confident. He that is soon angry dealeth foolishly, and a man of wicked deceives is hated. The inherit folly, but the prudent are crowned with knowledge. Verse 19. The evil bow before the good, and the wicked at the gates of the righteousness. In verse 2, if you look at verse 2, he says, he who walks in his uprighteousness fears the Lord, but he who is perverse in his ways despises him. Matthew 6. Okay. Matthew 6, verse 19 to 21. Matthew 6, 19 to 21. Mm-hmm. Yes, if you will.
Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Let's go to the principle of talents. We'll discuss that again. Which brings me to the principle of talents. After Christ had revealed some of his signs of his return, he told his disciples to watch and be ready. What is involved in watching for Christ? What is involved in watching for Christ's coming? Jesus gave this parable of the talents to answer this question. It is evident that Jesus intended that the time of waiting be spent in diligent labor. For the kingdom of heaven, it's Matthew 25:14-15. For the kingdom of heaven is as a man dwelling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to every man according to his several abilities, and straightway took his journey. What 2 things have been given to God's servant? What 2 things have been given to God's servants? Well, let's look and check Mark 13:34. Mark 13:34. For the Son of Man is a man taking a far journey, who left his house and gave authority to his servants, and to every man his work, and commanded the potter to watch. Work, watch. Mark 13:34.
There's a...
Yes.
I don't mean to interrupt you.
No, no, no.
I'm looking for a scripture that took me to find it. And it's talking about the mind, and it's in Jeremiah 17:9, and it says, the heart is deceitful above all things, and desperately wicked, who can know it? And so we don't know our own minds except through, as you're teaching here, honesty by knowing truth.
Absolutely.
So we can't trust our own mind.
No, we cannot.
Because like Gay just went through before us, he rationalized and he did this. So the mind was guiding him, not the truth, I guess, or whatever. And it's not just for us, I'm pointing out to anybody, that when we rationalize something we have said or done, we need to recognize immediately that we're on the downhill ride.
That's a good point.
And we need to stop, pray, and reverse our steps.
It's out of selfishness that we try to justify.
Yes. Yeah. We want to be right in the eyes, and the mind will lead us into lie after lie after lie.
And that's so easy.
Yes, it is.
It is so easy. You don't even have to practice.
No.
It comes out of magic.
It just is. It's the fallen nature.
Yeah.
It's the way of the world.
It is. You know? It's laughable, but yet, that's what it is.
Yeah. Yeah. It's laughable because now we see the other side of the fence. So
right.
We can compare, and we've been there, we've done that ourselves.
Absolutely. What talents has Christ entrusted his church through the Holy Spirit?
Gifts of the Spirit?
Yes. No. What talents has Christ entrusted to the church through the Holy Spirit?
To spread the gospel.
To one is given by the Spirit and the Word of wisdom. To another, the word of acknowledgement by the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, the gift of healing by the same Spirit. To another, the workings of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, discernment of spirit. To another, diverse kinds of tongues. And we've seen that. We've seen that at the beginning in Babel. To another, the interpretation of tongues. But all this work, worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. And you can find that in 1 Corinthians 12, 8 to 11. Some abilities are inherited. A natural bent for some things. Other abilities are acquired through training. Some abilities are supernatural and endowment of the Holy Spirit. Since we live and move and have our being in God, in a very real sense of our abilities have been given us of God. And if you look at Acts 17:28, you will further find the context of what I just spoke of in chapter, in the book of Acts. Let's go. This is another principle that I think is worthy. Upon what basis does God expect returns? Upon what basis does God expect returns? God has bestowed talents to each of his servants. It should be no concern of ours as to how many talents God has given us. We should, however, ask, what am I doing with the talents which I have received?
You know,
down to the point.
Your lead-off statement's really powerful. On what basis does God expect returns? On the basis that we were created in his image. And we are to have the mind of Christ in us.
Realizing we are supposedly, hopefully, his remnant. Mm. So as his remnants to the world, to the especially to the lost of this world, mm. we need to be portraying that image,
absolutely.
That character.
Right. Simply because he created us.
Absolutely.
And he redeemed us.
Absolutely he did. So all that we are, that we have, it's his.
It's his. And he expects a return.
Absolutely. We will find that out
yeah.
at judgment time. Mm-hmm. When you be asked for
yeah.
your accountability.
There you go. There
you go. What did you do in my behalf?
Right.
It's a powerful, powerful thing, I mean.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll find that he is justified in so asking us. Because he's given them all the instructions, all the guidance, and we have a comforter. So it's not like we can't go and get guidance.
We are without excuse.
We are absolutely without excuse. That's why he gave us the, and it's a good thing. He gave us free will, free choice. But it's what you do, it's what you know, and how you go about it. Let us go to Monday's lesson. The life of faith. Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. We all know how Abraham was tested and the outcome. Remember how he was tested? And wow, did he come out? You know, I mean, the world was smelling like roses. I mean, the faith that Abraham had, ought we also to have. The point here is that we, as professing Christians, are obligated to hold on to the faith that Abraham had. It's a kind of faith that should teach us that there is nothing too precious to be given to God. It is when we look upon every gift as the Lord's to be used in His service. As professing Christians, we have an inclination to earthly things. Our eyes are often focused on unsatisfying things that give us instant gratification. Our religious experience often shallow and unsatisfying. Question is, as Christians, are we not to be Christ-like?
We should be Christ-like.
Absolutely. So as faithful stewards, we should not be a one-time act. Over time, it will grow either deeper and stronger or shallower and weaker, depending upon how you claim that faith and exercise it. Well, yeah.
It's an interesting comment. Sorry, I keep interrupting.
No, and that's fine. That's what we ought to be doing.
On Abraham. And yes. On stewardship, so it's,
yes.
It's right here with the same
yes.
question.
Yes.
And it's a comment from Mrs. White. And it's from January 27, 1887. But here's she titled this, "Nothing Too Precious to Give to God." Mm-hmm. And she says, "This act of faith in Abraham is recorded for our benefit. It teaches us the great lesson of confidence in the requirements of God, mm-hmm. what He expects. Mm-hmm. However close and cutting they may be, and it teaches children perfect submission to their parents and to God. By Abraham's obedience, we are taught that nothing is too precious for us to give to God."
Absolutely.
And that was a test of all tests for a human.
Yes.
You know.
Not only God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are guides. But through Abraham, we were shown that man can be, and should be, actually.
And that everything is God. Even,
absolutely.
Even our children.
Absolutely.
Everything belongs to God. And Abraham exemplified that.
Absolutely.
In the act of sacrificing Isaac. In his mind, he did sacrifice Isaac, and that's when God stayed his hand.
Question is, how many of us would do that?
Yeah. Huh? And God provided his sacrifice.
Isn't that what the word is all about? Right. God provides?
He provided it.
So why do we worry?
Because we aren't
when
trusting.
We're already promised salvation. All that is promised to us already, given to us from the day of creation.
But so it's conditional.
You know, Abraham wasn't perfect.
No, he
wasn't. Because, I mean, yes, I'm not diminishing that at all.
No,
but
no,
he lied twice about Sarah
right.
being his half-sister.
Yeah.
He went into the concubine or
yes.
or whatever. Because you know, so that gives hope because
yes.
Abraham was
yeah.
not perfect.
Right.
So what did he do to render good what the wrong was? What did he render good? What did he do?
In what circumstance?
In what circumstance?
In the fact that he did this or did that.
He ended up becoming obedient.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But how
right.
did he
that's
do
what
it?
I'm saying. Gives you hope.
Yeah. How did he do that, though?
Yeah. He could never have offered Isaac. If he
right.
would have been obedient,
right.
if
right.
he wouldn't have gone through the trials he went through previously,
mm-hmm.
it taught him, it strengthened him, it guided him, and in his old age, he had learned to trust God. And he didn't understand this with Isaac. He had no understanding. That was the hardest 3 days he'd ever lived through.
I can imagine.
But he respected God to the point that he knew that if God did do this through his hand, he could also raise him up. And that was the hope that Abraham hung on to. disobedient.
Isn't God all loving?
He knew the promise God had given him.
Yeah.
And it wasn't from his other son, it was from Isaac.
Yeah.
He's all forgiven.
Yeah, and that was no guesswork from Abraham. An angel told him that Isaac is the promised seed, not Ishmael.
And if we wrong God in any form or way, there is a way of getting back in line with the word.
There is another lesson that I learned about this Isaac sacrifice, is that when God told him to do this, Abraham was living in a land where they regularly sacrificed their children. And that's another reason why God did this, to show Abraham that it's not through, and the other people, that it's not through sacrifice of their children, that it's sacrificed through Jesus. I mean, I had never heard that before. That was on the Hope Channel about,
So we need to remember that even though the nature that we are, we're going to sin. Because we're not perfect.
But we're not cast off either.
No. And the good part about it all is that having a merciful Father, all we have to do is reach out to Him in repentance.
That's right.
Because at the end, He wants everybody to have everlasting life.
Right.
Yeah.
Hey, Mom.
Yes, sir.
Seems to me, I may not be saying it right, but seems like to be the basis of all faith. Go back to Hebrews 11, that we read a while ago, verse 1, and read verse 3.
Go ahead and read it.
Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. If you go back to Genesis 1:1, like we said so many times, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth, and if you don't believe that, you're not going to have the faith to believe anything else in the Bible.
That's right.
That is so true. Yes. Because it all starts in Genesis 1, and we work ourselves all the way to Revelation. It's all the testimony that Christ came, brought to us. It's His testimony, the same testimony that you and I need to be carrying, especially for the lost of the world. We need to focus in trusting God, believing that He loves us and knows best what is for us, for our good, which should lead us to choose His ways. Our life are His, and as faithful stewards, we should have by now the acknowledgement of His ownership over us and accept it, and accept its blessings. It's through faith that the Lord God put in us in possession of His righteous principles in living a faithful life of stewardship. That becomes a reflection of His attributes in a Christian life for all of us. It's our duty as stewards to what God has provided us to apply His principles and do our part to fight the good fight of faith. We should set the Lord ever before us. Our goal should be in seeking to honor God in all ways. As faithful stewards, we will be sustained by the Spirit of God, who will lead us in all righteousness. All you have to do is ask. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and the door will be open. It's that simple. Yet, for lack of, or whatever, and the nature that we are, and the world as it is, has a very powerful hold on the masses. Let us go to Tuesday's lesson, the statement of faith. Romans 1, 15-18. In Romans 15, faith being a process and an experience that grows and matures. So as much as in me, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. Verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jews first and also to the Greek. Verse 17. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in righteousness. From faith to faith means faith is at the beginning of the salvation process, and it is the goal as well. When we first exercise faith in Christ, that person is saved from the penalty of sin and declared righteous. We, as the believers, live by faith, or should be. God's continues to save us from the power of sin to live righteously. In the past, the believer has been saved from the penalty of sin. And we've seen that throughout Scripture, starting from Genesis. And that's, you can find that in Ephesians 2:8. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourself, it is the gift of God. So faith in itself is a gift of God. In the present, quote, present, the believer is being saved by from the power of sin. In Corinthians 2, 2 Corinthians, verse 2, chapter 2, verse 15, for we are unto God a sweet savior of Christ in them that are saved and in them that perish. In the present, the believer is being saved from the power of sin. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 11. And finally, brethren, farewell, be perfect. Be of good comfort, be of one mind, live in peace, and the God of love and peace shall be with you. In the future, the believer will be saved from the very present of sin, which is where we're at now, the present, the now, and the coming. Matthew 5, verses 10 to 12. How we exercise faith should be made very plain. How we exercise faith should be very plain. To every promise of God, there are conditions. In order to strengthen faith, we must often bring it in context with the Word. And that's sure. And one way God is finishing our faith and bringing it to completeness is through the act of tithing. When we tithe, we are not working or seeking to earn our way to heaven. Instead, tithing is a statement of faith. Success in our Christian life depends upon the appropriation of the life that God has given us. thou hast fallen, no. James 2, verse 14. What does it profit, my brother, though a man says he hath faith and have not works? Can faith save you? These are powerful words, powerful verses, that as we go and do our study, we ought to be hearing, not only hearing, but taking his word as truth, and hearing to what he's trying to tell us. So we need to be open-minded, that we take truth, but not just take it blindly. We need to go and search, make sure that what we're being told is true, and that it's coming of him. And only we can do that by taking his word and studying, searching, reading, coming to a oneness, hoping that the Holy Spirit, being in us, will give us all the understanding that we need to further our salvation and our obligation in obedience to his word, to what he wants of each and every one of us. We own who we are. We are of him as long as we keep and portray the character and the principles and the instructions that he has given each and every one of us. He gives us everything that we need and that we have. God gave his son for us when we didn't deserve it. Who are we to withstand, withhold from him something that isn't even ours to begin with? Which leads me to another principle. Principle of responsibility. Although God gives us all things to enjoy, nothing is ours. Nothing really belongs to us. God owns everything. We're responsible for how we treat it and what we do with it. While we complain about our rights here on earth, the Bible constantly asks, what about your responsibility? Our owners have rights. Stewards have responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
Well said. Mm-hmm. Which brings me to the principle of being to stewards of money. That's another principle. I don't know if we have time to go through everything else, but there's plenty yet to be learned, to be said. Well, is it that time that we
pretty close.
Okay, then we'll go ahead and in this lesson, and we'll pray that the Lord today has instilled upon us, you know, has opened our eyes, especially our ears, that we need to be attentive as to what God's word is all about and what he's trying to teach us, to tell us. Because every time we take this book, his word, he is speaking to us as we read. He literally speaks to us. Whether through the Holy Spirit, through inspiration, through his word. We are being inspired every day. All we gotta do is obey. He gave us his instructions, the Ten Commandments. They're not hard. yet we make them hard. So it can be easy as you want it to be, or hard as you want, let it be. But let us put our faith and our endeavor onto His word, onto His truth. We as His remnants are more responsible than anybody else. The fact that we call ourselves His stewards, His remnant, we are obligated through the obedience of His word, that we need to take His word, His message. Genesis 1, Matthew 28, verse 19, which is our Great Commission, and expound more than ever before on Revelation 14, 6 to 12. That is our obligation today. That should be an inclination of holding on and taking it to the loft of this world. And with that, we shall end. Father in heaven, we thank you, for you have given us your word. You have opened up our hearts through your instruction. Father, we hope and reach out to you that the Holy Spirit in thy grace will put this instruction, put these principles in our hearts, that we may be counted worthy as good stewards in your remnant church, Father. For all belongs to you. You're in control, not me, not anyone. And so, Father, in Jesus' name, we praise your name, we glorify your name, and we thank you. Amen. And as we go, one more thing, and as we go about, let us also give thanks to the food that has been provided today and the hands that have provided it. For it all comes from the one and only Father in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.